Good evening and welcome to Second Presbyterian Church. This is our second in the concert series for 2021 and 22. I am Jim Rittenhouse, Director of Worship and Music Ministries here, and on behalf of our entire congregation and staff, our music committee and concert series committees, we welcome you to this. It's a splendid evening. You will see in the next hour or so some spectacular music played by a remarkable individual and musician. And you'll hear just a little bit more about Ken Cowan in just a moment. He brought the cold weather from Houston, by the way, so we're very glad that he did that. But I wanted to mention that we could not put on these programs without the generous donations of our congregation and others who give generously to the series all year long. And because of that, we get to feature some of our mission partners, and we'll speak about our partnership with some of the folks in El Salvador that we have a good relationship with, and you'll have an opportunity to also offer a donation if you care to, and we'll have a little bit more of that after our intermission. But I also wanted to mention to you that we do like hospitality around here, and so after our concert, our music committee has made sure that we have a fellowship time in our hall, fellowship hall down the back hallway here, and part of that as well. We thank the music committee and Lori Conway for providing that special time. This evening is about a magnificent instrument that this church has supported for so long, and we are delighted to introduce in a more public way our new organist, Samuel Libra, and I'm going to turn the microphone over to him to give a few words about Ken and some other items. Please welcome Sam.
Good evening. Welcome to Second. I'm so thrilled that you're here. I have had the immense privilege of hearing Ken perform on, I think, four occasions. And every time the repertoire has been different, it's been exciting. He's an incredible performer, and I know he's going to blow you away. You will hear things come out of this organ that you will never comprehend were possible. If you like what you hear, which I know you will, I'm sure you would he would love to have you purchase a CD, which are available via Amazon or different online purveyors. You can see those in his bio in your program. As we must do in this digital age, I'll remind you to silence this dreaded device, lest you be broadcast for all eternity to hear. Jim already mentioned that we have a reception following the program, but there's also an opportunity to hear Ken Moore tomorrow morning. The local chapter of the American Guild of Organists has graciously co-sponsored a masterclass here at Second at 10:30 in the morning, in which four young local organists will play and have an opportunity to be coached by Ken in a variety of wonderful organ repertoire, and that is free and available for all. And we hope you'll join us for that. Now, I hope you will join me in enthusiastically welcoming one of America's great organists, Ken Cowan.
Good evening, everyone. I'm thrilled to be here with you and to celebrate a whole group of great compositions as well as this magnificent instrument in Second Presbyterian Church. I thought we would start with music by a friend of mine, George Baker, who you might be interested to know after the 1970s when he had a spectacular career as a performing musician, decided that 30 years old wasn't too old to go to medical school, and so he became a medical doctor and has had a whole other career with concurrent compositional activities and performances all the while. So I think that he's branched out in about every way one could in one lifetime. He wrote that piece, L'Envoi, as a kind of pre-planned postlude for his daughter Paige's wedding when Mr. Wright comes along, and it happens. So that's why the festive character. We're going to turn now to two pieces from France, and I'll play them consecutively because the first ends so tranquilly. Gaston Litez was one of the great organists in France in the 20th century. He trained many of today's great generation of performing organists, and his style tends to be on the introspective side, and so in his lead, that's exactly the kind of tone you're going to hear at the beginning. It surges up into a more kind of yearning and restless middle section, but then returns to the tranquility of the opening. And then we'll follow that with Danse Macabre by Camille Saint-Saëns, who was one of the preeminent 19th century French composers. Danse Macabre is a piece of program music, which is to say that it's meant to tell a story in the music. And it fits very well with Halloween. So almost every year around the end of October, I tend to be playing this piece. And even though in retail, we're in Christmastide, I noticed that on your poster outside, decorations among the congregation are recommended on November 28th, so I'm hoping that we fit in our spooky piece before it's really meant to be Christmas. The story begins with the 12 chimes of the midnight hour, and at that time some very mysterious things begin to happen, and you'll hear kind of rustling of wind, and a character emerges carrying a violin. And so he begins to tune it. And you know, usually violins are tuned to this. He begins this way. That's the tritone, which was somewhat forbidden in medieval times because of what it might conjure. And so you'll hear then our first character dive into a kind of intense waltz. And before long, musical characters begin to come out of the woodwork, and they are all meant to be pictured dancing around a graveyard, basically. And things get stirred up into quite a frenzy before a more tranquil middle section takes over, but not for long. Pretty soon, this kind of tempestuous music returns, this time more intense than before. Things stop in their tracks on an E-flat, if you're keeping track, and at that point, you'll hear an imitation of a rooster call that's meant to say it's the dawn of a new day, and of all things, fairy tale and magical. But first, lead by Gaston Litez.
Thank you.
Chorale Fantasias by Max Reger are as intense as Saint-Saëns is light and playful. Reger wrote about a half a dozen of these fantasias, and what's very interesting about them is actually Reger was trying to evoke in a really careful way the text of the music that he was composing for. If you're interested in this particular text, it is Psalm 146, if it's in your pews. This song, Hallelujah, Gott zu loben, Hallelujah, may God be the joy of my soul, is the text of this particular piece. It begins with a really raucous introduction and finally settles in to the first stanza of the chorale, which you'll hear rumbling away in the bass. And if you haven't heard this chorale tune before, it goes like this. Beautiful festive tune. And so that spirit of joy pervades the entire first stanza, and then we start to get into a little bit of text painting. The second stanza of the hymn, it doesn't quite align with the verses of the psalm, but it begins, "Do not put your trust in rulers." Kind of a timeless idea, really, right? And so what you're going to hear is the bass line suddenly gets very disjunct and jagged and uncertain sounding to accompany that text. But before long, the following variation, you're going to hear one of the very beautiful reed stops called a dulcian. It's a little bit like a clarinet stop. Have a solo, and then the more kind of tranquil spirit emerges. Then the next stanza is talking about God, the creator of the seas and all things, and you're going to hear the music gradually broaden, get more and more animated, more and more intense in its dynamic. Then a very tranquil variation follows that. You'll hear the softest sounds in the instrument. And then the final stanza is set to a great fugue, where you're going to hear a kind of alleluia theme, if you will. You can imagine a chorus of angels singing it. And finally, you'll hear one more time that chorale melody come underneath this entire fugue theme, combine with it completely, and the text of the final verse is about God who reigns forever and ever.
Thank you.
Well, how about that? We all needed a little bit of an intermission there because such a phenomenal first half. We are indeed blessed in this congregation to have so much support for our series that we don't collect for the series during our concerts, and that is a really great gift because we like to spotlight our mission partners along the way. This church has a deep history of supporting missions, both local and obviously globally, through our different activities and, of course, our support and money. But what we particularly like to do is establish relationships with particular ministries. And we've had a long relationship with our partners in El Salvador at the Reformed Calvinist Church and also the community of Rosario de Mora. And several of our folks, some folks in the congregation, have gone on trips down there to establish these relationships. And a hallmark of these missions has been to support education. And so tonight we would love for you to make a donation towards that because we are making plans to support them in different ways, especially with scholarships to continue education for the young and also entrepreneurship. And it's a great gift that the folks who have gone down there have developed these relationships and we continue to support them. This last year was a little tough, as you can imagine, through COVID restrictions, and we only had an opportunity to send our associate pastor. But this year in February, there's a team that will be going down again to continue that great relationship. So we invite you, as you can see in the bulletin, the program here, the QR code, if you're inclined to do that kind of thing, is there. But you're welcome to put cash in our, the ushers will have some plates outside, and you can put a check in there made payable to the church, and we'll make sure that that gets to them especially. And I want to thank our music committee because they're the ones that have helped us get in and out of the doors here. We'll collect our offering and that support our mission here of music at Second Presbyterian. We're glad that you're here. Please stay afterwards and visit down the hall. It's just down the hall. You'll see the signs toward the fellowship hall. We'd love to see you and have an opportunity for you to visit with Ken as well. And we hope that you'll continue to come. There's lots of activities in the back of the program, particularly our next concert series event in March. It is the we are remounting our Splendor of the Baroque program that got canceled just 2 days before it was to happen because of the COVID shutdown back in 2020. So we would love to see you in March as well. Well, I know you're ready for this, so will you please welcome back Ken Cowan.
Gunnar Edenstam toured North America extensively decades ago, but now in more recent years has turned towards a variety of musical genres, rock, new age, classical, and composing as much as performing. I've been fascinated by his set of pieces called Cathedral Music, and this scherzo you will notice is subtitled Yoik, and this is a musical tradition that is found among indigenous people of northern Scandinavia, so that is to say northern Sweden, where Edenstam is from, Finland, Norway. Evidently, when you yoik something, which is to say that you don't yoik about it, you actually conjure a person, place, or thing by singing melodies about it. And in this case, it must have been something, someone, or some place that was very jolly, because it's a very exuberant melody you hear right in the beginning. And the way that Edenstam embellishes this swinging tune, the slow version would be. He adorns it with all kinds of creative accompaniments. And I would imagine the idea is to conjure this kind of mystical fairy tale landscape.
Thank you.
Gerald Finzi was an English composer in following the same tradition of the likes of Vaughan Williams, Elgar, and others. But unlike some of his contemporaries, he decided to give up the city life of London after he was finished school, and he moved into the English countryside, settled in Wiltshire, and ran an apple farm where he saved several species of apples from extinction and composed all the rest of his life. His romance was originally written in the late 1920s, but he lived with it and revised it until 1951, when it was finally published for string orchestra and arranged around the same time for organ solo. The beautiful soaring melodies and tranquil spirit of this piece, you can imagine the composer sitting looking over England's beautiful pastures green and thinking about days gone by.
Thank you.
pageant by Leo Sowerby takes the form of an introduction, like a fanfare, and then a set of variations on an original theme. The neat thing about this particular set of variations is that what Sowerby was trying to do is explore the various techniques that one can use with the organ's pedal board. I guess it's not often during church that you see there's a separate keyboard for the organist's feet, 32 notes or 2.5 octaves. And in Sowerby's day, one of the great organists of the world was an Italian virtuoso named Fernando Germani. And he was particularly well known for just how excellent his skills at playing the pedals were. So Sowerby sent him this piece shortly before Germani embarked on one of his many North American tours. In those days, you would have had to cross the Atlantic on a ship, and apparently Germani finished learning the piece on the boat by drawing lines on the floor and working out the various passage work, performed it on his tour, and then when returning home, he wrote a thank you note to Sowerby. And legend has it that among the things that he said to him were, thank you very much for your excellent piece, and that he wished another time Sowerby might try to write him something that was actually difficult.